Father, we're thankful that you never minimize the depth of our sin. And because you never minimize the depth of our problem, you never minimize the depth of the solution. And we are grateful, Lord, that you have saved us from the depth of our sin. And not just with superficial solutions, but with your Son, sent on our behalf to die in our place, to live in our place, and to rise from the dead, to conquer our sin, so that we could know you. Lord, I thank you for this precious gospel and pray that as we think today about this very hard subject of what it means to be sinful, depraved, fallen, in rebellion against you, that you would help us to move out of self-deception and rationalizing and excusing and redefining and euphemizing, and help us, Lord, to please understand the depth of our sin better so that we understand the depth of your grace better. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Great hymn of the faith. As we went through it, gang, was there a doctrine that we've been studying that particularly jumped out at you that this was affirming? Totally depraved, right? Total depravity is what this is talking about. What does Grudem call it? He prefers a nuance on that term. He doesn't like to call it total depravity as much as what? What does he call it? You remember? Well, read more carefully. Total inability. He also prefers a term over original sin and calls it what? Or inherited sin, right? Something we've inherited from God. So this hymn talks about our total inability. Rock of Ages, cleft for me. Augustus Toplady, the author of this hymn, apparently was riding through the Lake District in northern England and came across this massive torrential downpour and thunder and lightning storm, and he jumped off his horse and found safety in a cleft of a rock, a massive rock. I have a picture of that rock in my office. I should have brought it. But this great line was inspired by that experience. Rock of Ages, speaking of who? Jesus, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, broken for me, opened up for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Guys, this is so vital. We hide in the shelter of the cross. We hide in the cleft Rock of Ages, the broken rock, and we hide in him. And as you grow in Christ, it never means you now venture out of that safety. It never means, oh, I've grown in holiness so I can venture out from underneath the shelter of Christ and his work. It always means, actually, the more you grow in Christ, the more you move into that shelter, not out of it. You recognize more and more how desperately you need that cleft in that rock, that you need Jesus to do this for you. And this is total inability to save yourself. That's the point here. Let the water and the blood from thy riven side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Cleanse me from its guilt and power. Remember that term. We're getting back to it later. The double cure. That's an important theological concept. And a hint of what that is in this next line. Cleanse me from its guilt and power. Sin has power over us in our fallen state, and we're guilty in that sinful state. And Jesus frees us from both the guilt and the power. We'll get to that. But remember this term, the double cure. Then this great line, not the labors of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal, my effort, no respite know? Could my tears, the sorrow for my sin, forever flow? All that for sin could not atone. That can't take care of it. That can't reunite me with you. You must save. Thou must save, and thou alone. God needs to do this. Not the labors of my hands, not the work I do. And then this great line, guys, look. Nothing in my hand I bring, nothing, nothing, simply to thy cross I cling, naked, nothing that you're wearing, come to thee for dress, helpless, not in need of a little help or a lot of help, helpless. You need all the help. Foul, I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. Either you do it or it's not going to happen. This is so offensive. So offensive to fallen, proud Americans. the culture of self-made men and women. The pull yourself up by your bootstraps. Show people how significant you are because of all you've accomplished. Oh, I think more than anything, this is the offense of the cross. Oh, it's offensive because it's a naked, bleeding man, but it's offensive because he does it all and you do nothing. You contribute nothing to it. You know, on the day of judgment, Mother Teresa will not come before God with 35 years in Calcutta. You know that, right? Did you see this, Lord? Did you see my standing before you based on this? You will come to God with no resume. Nothing in my hand I bring. Nothing. They're empty. Nothing in my hand I bring. Simply to thy cross I cling. Beautiful picture. Naked come to thee for dress. So nothing in my hand, naked, helpless, foul. Do you realize how offensive this is? Even in a Christian culture, this is offensive. And we figure out every way we can to explain away, rationalize, excuse, redefine, talk about sin in a way where it actually ends up being affirming to you. I've never heard, you know how people say, oh, I'm a perfectionist, as if they really think it's a fault. Or they'll say, oh, I know God forgives me, but I just can't forgive myself. And they're saying it like it's bad, but they don't really mean it. They really think there's something good about that. They really think there's something good about being a perfectionist. This is one of those things you say when they ask you what your faults are in a job interview. No, I'm a perfectionist. That's just so bad. And I'm so proud of it. And God forgives me, but I just can't forgive myself because, you know, I just have higher standards. We actually are constantly wanting to bring our resume to God. And this total inability is so offensive to us. And Christians who get this, though, I know some of you just sang that. And there was actually an ability, because you get the gospel so well, to enjoy singing about your own inability. I know some of you have gotten to that point where it's not offensive to you any longer to acknowledge that you are foul as you fly to his fountain of cleansing grace. You get it. You get it to the point where it's no longer offensive. It's actually so comforting because you know until you realize this helplessness, you'll never flee like you need to. And so we affirm our depravity and find comfort in the midst of it, because we're pulling ourselves out of self-deception when we do this. We're not believing the messages you've been hearing from teachers and coaches and parents, many of you, your whole life, that you can do anything you want to. You can do anything you set your mind to. That is such a lie. God can do anything he sets his mind to. You can't save yourself. And then this line, while I draw this fleeting breath, this is true right to death, when my eyelids close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne, what will be my standing before him? Look how faithful I was at my church. No, rock of ages cleft for me. It's still the same thing. Let me hide myself in thee. You're never moving out from under his shelter, his care, his provision for you. Powerful song that gets at the heart of our utter depravity before God and our inability to do anything about it. Okay, the doctrine of sin. We continue to seek to answer the question, what is sin? And I walked out the door this morning, and there's somebody staying with us, and I said to him, well, I'm going to go teach on sin all day. And there's such a burden in this. But there's such a desperate need. So with a burden, I went enthusiastically to do this. Because as I've said before, we talked about this last time. Of all the things we teach, this is not the hardest to understand. It's not as hard as the Trinity. It's not as hard as the divine and human natures of Christ. It's not as hard as other things to understand. But I have no doubt it's the hardest thing for us to accept. I talk to people about Christ a lot, and I'll be talking to them, and they'll be going down the road with me on just about everything we believe, even that Jesus died for our sins. But then when I want to start to define sin, in the way the Bible does, man, the brakes just slam on. And the willingness to understand sin in its true depth, the way the Bible teaches it to be, is so difficult for us. And so answering this question, what is sin, is profoundly difficult for us to really take to heart. Especially as we said last time, where you see the word sin used more anywhere else than on dessert menus. That's where you see sin used most in our culture to describe the chocolate lava cake. What does that do to you when you want to think the way God does about sin when it's used to describe chocolate lava cake more than anything else in our culture? And then you've got a church that realizes how offensive this is, so we constantly are trying to find ways to explain our way around it. Well, we needed to find this the way the Bible does. We started last time by saying on page 78, these two excellent definitions. Sin is any lack of conformity, active or passive, to the moral law of God, which reflects His character. This may be a matter of act, of thought, or of inner disposition or state. And then Buswell says, sin is anything in the creature which is not expressed or which is contrary to the holy character of the Creator. That's a great definition because of how God-centered it is. And that's where I want to get right now. We said last time as we started to unpack this definition, sin is a particular kind of evil, namely moral evil, not natural evil. Moral evil causes natural evil. But this next point, folks, if you get nothing else out of this whole doctrine of sin, get this one. Sin is personal. It's personal. And by that, I mean it's a personal offense that persons commit against a very personal God who takes sin personally. There is an effort to define sin only horizontally, only sociologically, psychologically, relationally, on a human level. Or personally, that's where sin gets defined most these days, the effect on you as a person. But please realize, sin is personal in that it's an offense against the holy God. Fundamentally, we've got to see sin as us shaking our puny little ridiculous fist. That's a fist. It's intended to look ridiculous because, not that I could improve on it anyway, but it's intended to look ridiculous because it is. It's expressing hatred toward God. That's how the Bible defines sin. Hatred toward God. It defines sin in response. God responds with wrath. We are enemies of God. We offend Him with our hatred, with our enmity, and He responds with wrath and judgment. Rightly. That's His rightful response at our rebellion against Him. And please, we live in a culture that's constantly trying to define sin as mistakes, as youthful indiscretions, as something that's a result of, you know, I have a collection at home, I should have brought it, of so-called apologies and confessions of athletes who've been caught cheating, mainly by taking steroids and putting cork in their baseball bats. And not one of them's a real apology. Not one of them's a real confession. Every one of them is talking about it in a way where there's not ownership of that sin. And we've learned to talk about sin in ways that excuse us at every turn. Listen to how the Bible describes sin. Deuteronomy 12:31. You shall not worship the Lord your God in that way. Check this out. When you go in the land, don't worship me the way the Canaanites worship their gods. He's not even saying don't worship false gods. He's saying don't worship me in the wrong way. You shall not worship the Lord your God in that way. For every abominable thing that the Lord hates, they have done for their gods. God hates sin. That's His response. Our problem is His hatred toward our hatred. And listen to David. Guys, this is so important. This verse is so massive for us. This is David confessing and repenting of what sins. What's he confessing here? Do you remember in Psalm 51? Adultery, Aurora, good, murder. And how about betraying your whole nation and your office as king? It's a time kings were to go out to war and defend their nations. That's what it says at the beginning of the narrative. And instead of going out to war like a good king would and preserving the nation, he's gawking at Bathsheba. He betrays his whole nation. He betrays his kingly office. He commits adultery. And then he sends her husband Uriah out to the front lines and has him murdered, in effect. And his dear friend Nathan comes to him, gets in his face, and wisely brings about an awareness of his sin, and it brings David to repentance. And this vital verse that some of you are memorizing nails it, doesn't it? Listen to what he says to God against you. You only I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified when you speak and blameless when you judge. Guys, that's confession. That's repentance. Do you know how to confess well? Do you know how to repent well? Where you don't constantly look for escape hatches the whole way? Do you know how to own sin? How about apologies like this? I'm sorry you feel that way. Is that an apology? No, that's a way of saying you're kind of touchy. I'm sorry if you think I hurt you. It sounds like somebody, you've heard these. Yes, yeah. Those are not apologies. Please realize we've learned to think about and talk about sin and apparently confess and repent. That is not confession and repentance. That is, against you only you have I sinned. Now, is David saying his sin against Bathsheba and the people and Uriah wasn't significant? No, he's not minimizing that. What's he doing? He's putting it in perspective. He's saying, oh, I sinned against Bathsheba. I've sinned against Uriah. I've sinned against my people. But my problem is with God. He's the one I need to answer to. Doesn't mean you don't need to work this stuff out horizontally, but the grounding is a very vertical awareness. It's God I need to deal with. It's God I've offended. It's God whose laws I've broken. And so it's against God. Listen to how James talks about our sin. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Listen to how the Bible describes sin, guys. You're an enemy of God in this standing. Look, listen to Romans. If while we were enemies... That's your pre-conversion state, an enemy of God, a fist-shaking rebel. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more now that we are reconciled, shall we be saved by his life. Enemies of God, hatred toward God, that's your fallen state. Now let me talk to you. Most of you were raised in wonderful Christian homes. Most of you were. I know they got issues. I know some of you had rough families, rough homes. But most of you have had wonderful preservation from the effects of human depravity in this world. You've had this wonderful God-given insulation and training so that your heart has not run in the directions it naturally would have. So the effect of sin from without, the effect of sin from within, has been wonderfully restrained by this blessing of family and churches and nurture. But what's the danger in that? Talk to me. Yeah, you don't see. It's hard to imagine you're an enemy of God. You know, I can remember I came to Christ as a little kid, and although I had hard things, I remember as even a little kid singing that hymn, years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified. Do you even know that hymn? No? Well, never mind then. But that line, years I spent in vanity and pride before I came to Christ, you know what? Four, just live this wild life of rebellion. Yeah, we kind of laugh. Well, please believe you can see wild rebellion in little kids. You never have to teach a kid to be selfish, ever. That's the default mode. But you do get preserved by, and the danger is you really don't believe you're depraved. Well, certainly not as much as that prostitute walking Skid Row right now. And you actually put yourself in a different category in your depravity and in your need for forgiveness then. When there's this amazing leveling of our fallenness, where Mother Teresa needed Jesus to die for her just as much as Charles Manson. aren't these categories of people when we talk about our fundamental fallen condition before God, where we inherit the guilt of Adam and the corruption of Adam. Please don't confuse the way God has protected you from where your heart would have gone otherwise. Please realize how desperately wicked each of us is, and don't let the grace of God in your life prevent you from seeing that. So it's hard, though. It's hard. So it's an offense against a holy God. But are we taught to think that way? No, generally not. The most heard preacher on a Sunday morning in the world for the past 30 years until recent years, do you know who it is? For the past 30 years, there's been one preacher on a Sunday morning who had been heard more than anyone else. Do you know who that is? Right down the road. Crystal Cathedral. No, 30 years, Rick Warren's not that old. Robert Schuller at the Crystal Cathedral has been the most heard preacher on a Sunday morning of anyone in the world. And listen to how he defines sin in his book, Self-Esteem, The New Reformation. Here's what Schuller says. And these are public affirmations. Public affirmations that have been confronted and unapologetically held to. And so I feel complete freedom to say and just talk about how influential this is. And this ministry has talked about sin in this way that has now opened up a whole massive way of doing preaching and the church and theology in America that really is, you may not realize it, but this is the way to grow a massive church. It's to preach this way. So here's what he says in his book, Self-Esteem, The New Reformation. He says, the root problem of evil is sin, okay? And sin is essentially a weakness or a helplessness, an inability to trust anyone, and therefore an inability to love or be loved. As a consequence, humans possess a poor self-image and are beset with a tragic sense of their own worthlessness. For them, life is at best boring and at worst despairing. What is the origin of our sinful actions? Lack of trust in ourselves, which makes us anxious, afraid, and defensive. And then we imagine that God is angry at us. The traditional view that we're rebellious sinners is shallow and insulting. In order to love God, humans need non-judgmental acceptance so that we can begin to love ourselves. Then we can pray, Our Father in heaven, honorable is our name. Positive Christianity does not hold to human depravity, but to human inability. I am humanly unable to correct my negative self-image until I encounter a life-changing experience with non-judgmental love bestowed upon me by a person whom I admire so much that to be unconditionally accepted by him is to be born again. The gospel message is potentially dangerous if it was to put people down before it attempts to lift them up. So we need to question even terms like unconditional love, don't we? Because this is usually what people mean by it. Does God love us unconditionally? Well, actually, no, he doesn't. He loves us on the condition that our sin is paid for. It's just that condition was met by Christ. Oh, there's condition, but God's met it. And so it ends up being unconditional. But what happens is we go around the condition being met in Christ to now find the unconditionality in something in ourselves. So I hope you realize this. What it is at its core is a profoundly human-centered approach to doing theology. Let me ask you this, though. Isn't this true? Doesn't sin put us in a position of not being able to love or be loved? We have a hard time being loved and loving, don't we? Isn't that true? Aren't we weak? Aren't we helpless? Don't we have poor self-image? Don't we have a sense of worthlessness and a boredom with life? Hasn't sin done all that then? Then what's the problem? That's all true, isn't it? So what's the problem? That payment has to happen. God needs to provide this. And we need to acknowledge the effects of sin. We need to acknowledge the symptoms. We don't minimize that because, after all, that's what we and people feel. We feel the symptoms. And so to say, I don't care about your symptoms, isn't what we need to do. We do acknowledge and need to care about the symptoms, but always get to the core issue. One of my favorite philosophers speaks to this issue. Mike Tyson is brilliant on this issue. You guys know Mike Tyson? You remember Mike before he was crazy? He's always been a little crazy. But I love Mike. He's like a little hobby of mine. I'm fascinated by him. And Mike says some brilliant stuff at times. Like, I think it was Trevor Burbick. I can't remember. I think it was Trevor Burbick who, Mike was killing everybody in the 90s, right? When you were in your mother's womb. But he was killing everybody. And they said, hey, Trevor Burbick's got a plan, Mike. He said he figured out a plan how to beat you. What do you think? And Mike Tyson said, everybody's got a plan. Until they get punched in the mouth. That is a great quote. Love that. Everybody's got a plan until they get punched in the mouth and the plan goes out the window. He says some brilliant stuff and some crazy stuff. But remember he bit Evander Holyfield's ear a couple times and he lost his boxing license. So to get it back, he had to go to 6 months of therapy at a ranch in Arizona and get evaluated to see if he could box again, which is kind of funny in itself. We need to give you a psychological evaluation to find out if you're psychologically fit to beat people up for a living. So, but anyway, he comes out and he was interviewed and I said, Mike, what'd you learn? And he said, I learned two very important things about myself. One, I have absolutely no self-esteem. And two, I may be the biggest egomaniac on the planet. Now you hear that and you say, well, it's either or. No, it isn't. He's right on the money. There's this relationship between egomania and insecurity. It really is. When you put yourself in the center of the universe, you always have a sneaking suspicion you don't belong there. And you can't keep that going. And so you get a little bit crazy. And so we need to acknowledge the lack of self-esteem and the lack of security and the victimization that the fallen world has had on us. We need to weep for people and with people and grieve over those effects and not minimize them, but never reduce the effects and never make the effects the cause. And never lose the ability to define all of that sadness as a rebellion that that person and you are a part of. Guys, could the Bible be any more clear? Hatred toward God. Enemy of God is how it defines it. We have some godly friends, Nate and Kim Winters, who named their son, their firstborn child, their son, they named him Joseph Micaiah Winters. You guys know who Micaiah is in the Bible? And the 2 Kings. Oh, it's too bad. He's a one-hit wonder. He shows up, we never see him again. Never saw him before, never shows up. He ends up, and the kings, Jehoshaphat and the other king, are getting together to decide if they should go to war. And so they call these prophets in who are just telling the kings what they want to hear. And they're saying, they have these horns on saying, go, O king, and you will be victorious. And Jehoshaphat just knows that something's not right. So he turns to the other king and he says, is there a prophet of the Lord around we could hear from? And the king says, well, there's one. But I hate him. Because he never says anything good about me. And Jehoshaphat says, that's the one I want to hear from. So apparently they go and get Micaiah out of prison because he never says anything good about the king. And they say, should we go to war? And he mocks the prophets. He says, oh, go, O king, and you will be victorious. And they say, what do you really think? And Micaiah says, go to war, you're going down. And all these prophets, they all have a lying spirit in their mouths. The lead prophet comes over, slaps him in the face. The king says, see, I told you. Never says anything good about me. And as they're taking him back to prison, he looks over his shoulder and he says, I can only say what the Lord has given me to say. So Nate and Kim named their son Joseph Micaiah Winters. And I talked to Kim on the phone a while back, and I say, hey, how's Joe doing? And she says, well, we've had quite a controversy around here. I said, what happened? She said, well, he homeschooled for a while. Then we put him in the public school in first grade, and he caused all kinds of problems. I said, what happened? And she said, well, we thought he had the tact to share his faith at this point in his life, but we just found out he didn't. And they think we're crazy over there. We had to have parent-teacher meetings. I said, what did he do? She said, well, the first week of school, he asked his teacher Do you believe in Jesus? Do you love Jesus? And she said, with sort of disdain, no, I don't believe in Jesus. And she said, Joe's eyes got really big. And he said, oh, well, that means you're an enemy of God. I mean, nah, pull the fire alarm. And, you know, I say, well, Kim, you named the kid Micaiah. After all, right? It's like he's the only one telling the truth these days. Maybe we need a little more sensitivity to timing and such. But he's telling the truth. Can we talk that way anymore? Okay, all right. So Joe's on to something. Okay. Next point. We need to hate sin like God does. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. This is talking about the Messiah, exalting his greatness, why he is the Messiah. Out of Psalm 45, we find out in Hebrews 1:9, this is talking about Jesus. And listen to this description of his character. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. And guys, you can't have one without the other. You can't have true love without true hatred. I know the slogans today. Don't be a hater. Why are you such a hater? Stop hating. Why are y'all hating? I know that. And I get that. But I got to tell you that Christians have got to be really good haters. As long as you're hating the right stuff in the right way. This idea that hatred is always bad leaves us no category for the Messiah. I think we should get t-shirts, be a good hater, or hate well, or I'm a hater. Just all the right stuff. And on the back, list some of the right stuff. Child abuse, sex trafficking, abortion. You can just list all this. So people say, oh, I guess I should hate those things. And restore a category of hatred, because God's a good hater, and we should be too. We should hate sin. We should hate evil. And if you don't, you're not a lover. We think love is the only good thing when hate is necessary. If you love kids, you hate child abuse, period. You can't have one without the other. And so let's realize God hates our hatred. He hates rebellion against him and all the effects that has. Not just the effects, not primarily the effects, but he hates hatred. He hates evil. He hates sin. Now, what is sin? Let's keep going, unpacking this definition. It's a violation of the moral law of God. The moral law of God reflects his character. It's not a bunch of rules. It's something he has selected and put out. He tells us to live this way because that's what he loves and what he hates. It's a violation of the moral law of God. Now, there are sins of omission as well as sins of commission. What's a sin of omission? Not doing what you should. Good. So a sin of commission is? Doing what you shouldn't. Right. What gets all the attention in the church? Commission. Why? Why does that get all the attention? Yeah, you can spot it. You just lied. Right? It's a lot harder to spot. You lack a gentle spirit. You don't care about the poor, do you? Those sins of omission are a lot harder to spot, but we need to seek to be discerning about those as well. Now, guys, please, whatever it takes, pound a Monster energy drink, slap yourself, pinch yourself, whatever. We need to listen. These two points are vital and they're in tension with one another, B and C. Here we go. The breaking of one of God's commands is enough to show that a person is a sinner. To fail at one point is to be guilty of breaking the law of God as a whole. James 2:10, whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking it all. Galatians 3:10, all who rely on observing the law are under a curse, for it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue to do everything written in the book of the law. Vital point here. When you sin, it shows an attitude toward God. Not just his law, because his law is a reflection of his character. You know, I'm infamous among my friends and family for disregarding doctor's orders. I've had a reckless bent in my life, and I've had some injuries to show for it. I was always the kid in the neighborhood. if a bunch of us are sitting around saying, I wonder if you could ride a bike off the roof and make it to the pool. I was the one who would try, typically. We used to have a competition in my town. Who could get across Colony Pond in Ansoni the fastest in the winter after it froze over? First. So whoever could get across it first every winter was the champion of the pond that year. And so that's kind of crazy, right? You want to, and my friend Kurt Bewald, always, he lived right next to the pond. He was always able to figure out the day he could make it without falling in. And I said, 1 year, I am going to beat Kurt this year. So I put my skates on, and it looked pretty thin, but I said, I think I can get across it. And I'm flying across that pond with a crack chasing me the whole time. I got about to the middle, right over my head. Oh, I popped out, and I'm trying to crawl out, and the ice is breaking. My friend's laughing on the side. But anyway, that's how I live. So I that's been a lot of my life. And I made it out somehow. But and so when you live that way, you go to the doctor, right? And I'm sort of famous for, you know, going out in the garage 4 weeks before the cast is supposed to come off, finding a saw and cutting it off. And or coming home with a bottle of pills and going and throwing them out and just sort of ignoring doctors. My wife hates this about me. Hates it. Because she's very insightful. She says to me, Eric, he went to school his whole life to know what you need when you break your ankle. And you know better? No, I actually think I do sometimes because they just don't want to get sued. This is all on film. What in the world? They just don't want to get sued. They don't want to get sued, so they overextend their requirements so you don't come back and sue them. And so I don't need it. I'm not going to sue them, so I don't have. So anyway, bad excuses, I know. Here I go. Good example of rationalizing. But my wife says this. She said he went to school his whole life. So what she's saying, when you disregard the doctor's orders, you're not just saying something about the order, are you? What are you saying something about? Yeah, I'm saying something about the doctor. Like, I know better. He doesn't know what he's talking about. So realize when you break one of God's commands, you're not just saying something about the command, you're saying something about the giver of the command. You know better. Isn't that the problem we've had since the Garden of Eden? Don't eat of that tree. We'll be the judge of that. Thank you very much. We will determine good and evil for ourselves. Thank you. We will dethrone you and enthrone ourselves, in other words. We'll put ourselves above you. Can you see why God hears this as hatred? Can you see why he hears it as not just a passive indifference to him, but a fish-shaking rebellion against him? And you may be able, by the grace of God, to acquire some moral, ethical goodness in your life, but realize that in your heart is a rebellion against God in your fallen condition. Got it? Got B? This is what prevents you from ever seeing anybody in a different category than you because you haven't committed certain sins. You can never look down on anybody who has expressed their depravity in ways you have, and you can't do that. Because any expression of sin is a reflection of a depraved nature that is equally true of all humans. So point B is vital, but guys, it's intentional with point C. Because one sin is indicative of an equally fallen condition doesn't mean God necessarily sees all sins the same. The Bible a lot talks about sins that are worse than other sins. So let's not be simplistic in our understanding of B. You know, the angel of the Lord takes Ezekiel for a tour in the temple. He wants him to see how bad it's gotten. So he says, come here, Ezekiel, I want to show you how bad it's gotten. Look at these people worshiping Baal. You think that's bad? Let me show you a far greater sin. Remember, watch these priests offer sacrifices and turn to the sun and worship it. You think that's bad? Come here, I'll show you something worse. Look at these women sacrificing their children in the fires to Molech. See, he's got this sense of it's gotten worse and worse and worse. And so let's not be simplistic in our understanding of B, and let's probably not use the Christian cliche, all sin is the same, or sin is sin before God. Sin is sin. It's all the same. Now, there's truth to that because of point B, right? But it's probably too simplistic because of point C. God knows that stealing an apple to feed your family is not the same as mass murder. Yes? There are progressions of sin. It's wrong and evil to hate people, to have hatred in your heart. It's wrong and evil to lust. That's why Jesus, and it's indicative of a fallen condition we equally share. That's why Jesus talks to those cocky Pharisees and says, "Oh, you've never committed adultery, so you think you're fine? Well, have you lusted after a woman in your heart? Because you know what that is. It's the same seed right there. You think you're in some different category?" And that's point B. But God knows that as wrong as it is to hate in your heart, it's then wrong, more wrong to express that hatred and punch somebody in the mouth. And then it's another step to pull out a knife and stab them. So God gets a degree of sinfulness at the same time, realizing the equally fallen condition we're in. You got it? This is a little tough because it blows up a Christian cliche that all sin's the same. Yes? Got it? Yeah? Okay. The reason the Bible gives for degrees of sin are lots of reasons, like knowledge. There's some sin done with more knowledge than other sins. You know. So then on 80, you see these other differences. There's difference in intent. They'd all have the same numbers, don't they? That's not good. I need to fix that. The numbering's off there. So there's different intent. Numbers 15 talks about sin done with a high hand. I wish it left it literal there in the ESV. Done with not anything done defiantly. Literally in Hebrew, that's with your hand raised high. Oh, that's a good image, isn't it? It's this, right? It's this hand in rebellion. The Bible recognizes the difference between this and this and this and this. Now, sin done in ignorance is still sin. But the Bible recognizes a knowledge or an intent in that sin when someone commits it. So there are degrees of sin. There's kinds of sins that are abominations to God. There's an effect of sin we need to recognize. Some sin has a bigger effect than others. So we acknowledge the difference in the midst of acknowledging the equal depravity we all share. Yes? Well, I think some of the implications are, one, because of point B, we never put ourselves in a better category than somebody who's committed a certain kind of sin that we haven't. So that's one implication. Another implication is we don't despair because we think we're in that other category because we have committed a sin. We recognize that every human being is in the same fallen condition before God. But then the implication with C is that we take sin really seriously. And we realize that sin is progressively offensive, more and more offensive to God and has a greater effect on God and gets further and further away from His intention in creation and breaks things more and more and destroys things more and more. So this is a good example. So I'm preaching on this on Sunday at church. This idea that we live in a world that is decaying. And in some ways, the decay is so pervasive and universal that that's the big problem. But we can do things to speed up that decay. You're going to die no matter what. Judgment's coming. But you can do things to speed up that impending death. Spiritually, physically, socially, relationally. You can accelerate the effects of the fall in your life by the decisions you make. We need to take that seriously. Never to the point of despair because Jesus came and took care of it all. But we take it seriously at the same time. If you're a child of God, you incur discipline. You incur broken fellowship. The relationship will stay the same. But any good parent will know you don't act the same way to your kid in rebellion as you do when there's humility and obedience. There's a difference in the relational dynamic we need to take seriously. Because Jesus took our place and we stand in His righteousness, that's so true and we need to live in that. But we shouldn't then minimize the ongoing reality of the dynamic of our relationship with Him, where my loving kindness is toward those who fear me. There's a blessing of a parent expressed to a child who's walking in obedience that a child in rebellion doesn't have. And so we need to appreciate that ongoing relational dynamic in the midst of resting the finished work of Christ, just like we start. That's why we needed to start with nothing in my hand I bring. You never, at the end of the day, bring something before God because of that abiding in Him. You even realize that's God initiated and enabled at the end of the day. The point here is sin has a universal equality, but it's also got a very real degrees when it comes to expressing it before God. And that does have implications. It doesn't mean we come ever with anything but our righteousness in Christ before Him at the day of judgment, but it does have relational, and in some ways, effects on the final judgment in the way that plays itself out. How that translates into eternity is very hard to understand. The Bible does not go into that very much for us, but it seems to have an effect on the end time judgment realities in the way we live right now. Okay, last major point on unpacking the definition of sin is number five. We need to keep going. Four, page 80, wow. Sin exists in our very nature, our hearts, as well as specific external actions. It's so important. For out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony, slander. Out of the heart, these are heart issues. Exodus 20, you shall not covet your neighbor's house. It doesn't say don't go rob your neighbor's house. It says don't want to. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife. That means don't, it's not saying don't commit adultery. It's saying don't want to. So heart attitudes are what's commanded. Hebrews 13, make sure that your character is free from the love of money. It doesn't say don't steal, it says don't want to steal. Heart attitudes, inclinations of the heart is what God's after. Sin is originating in the heart. Calvin calls our hearts idol factories. That's what we punch out of our hearts, is idol factories until God gets a hold of them. And so on the top of 81, we have these commands that in the positive are issues from the heart. So sin is an issue of the heart, so is righteousness. We're commanded to forgive from the heart, to love one another with heartfelt intensity. Other emotions, the joy, hope, fear, peace, zeal, grief on 81. Look at all these positive emotions that are commanded by God. Sin and righteousness are issues of the heart. Now this blows up two other Christian cliches. One is, love the sinner, hate the sin. I get that. There's truth to that. Because God and we should always have love toward everyone. But I do think it's simplistic to talk that way. And the Bible doesn't talk that way. And I think it's ultimately not helpful to create a false dichotomy between the sinner and sin. I mean, you don't say love someone's admirable behaviors, but not you don't love the person. Now, you can't start talking this way outside of this class much when we have all this background. But there's a godly hatred we should feel. Listen to what the psalmist says. He says, where do I have it? Yeah, this description of, where is it? I already talked about the Messiah hating evil. Yes. So love the sinner, hate the sin, I think is a simplistic false dichotomy that leads us to think about sin as only external actions and not something that's a matter of the heart. And so Jesus says, you know a tree by its fruit. And please realize that God loves people, and I think He has a godly hatred toward people and not just what they do, because what they do flows from who they are. And this is really tough to talk about because it's a godly hatred. It's a hatred mingled with love and compassion and patience and grace, and for us never with self-righteousness. And so it's hard to talk about because our hatred almost always is infused with those things. But I don't want us to have this false dichotomy between sin and sinners. At the end of the day, God, I believe, sends the wicked to hell, not wicked actions to hell. And so let's not speak in simplistic ways that is perpetuated by cliches like love the sinner, hate the sin. Although there's truth to that, I wonder if it's ultimately helpful. And the other cliche is, when you think about positive heart attitudes that are commanded, what about this one? Well, I need to love you, but I don't need to like you. What that really means is, I need to love you, but not really. Not to the point where it's coming from my heart, earnestly, like a brother. heartfelt intensity of my forgiveness and my love. Now, I believe there is a process. A lot of times when I seek to love people, it starts with acting like it. And I pray for the good of people that I feel hatred toward. And that's really hard to do. But cliches like this, I think, need to be rethought. Okay, last major point in unpacking the definition. Sin results in both guilt and pollution or corruption and depravity. Here we go again. Be of sin the double cure. In our sin, we're both guilty and polluted. Do me a favor. Jot down your definition of guilt. Define guilt. Just jot it down. How would you define guilt? Write that down for me. Okay. I've done this enough to know that probably the majority of you, somewhere in your definition, have a derivation of some kind of the word feeling or feel. I get that, but I want you to know that at its core, the definition of guilt is not a feeling. Listen to this. It's from the Chicago Tribune. Article entitled, "Murderer is Given Life in Prison." In a bizarre courtroom outburst at his sentencing Thursday, a convicted murderer yelled at the family of the woman he killed, corrected prosecutors, and boasted that he didn't feel the need to apologize for his crime. Moments later, Lake County Judge John Gregorian gave Mark Lindsay, 39, life in prison without parole. The judge said, "Anyone who was in the courtroom would certainly say there was a total lack of remorse." Lindsay was convicted of first-degree murder on December 1st for killing his girlfriend of 3 months, Lorna Abrams. Lindsay took Abrams, 34, for a drive and wound up stabbing her more than a dozen times in a naval training center. He left the mother of five bleeding to death in a parking lot on the base in the early morning hours of April 24th and was arrested a short time later. "I killed the woman. I'm not trying to say let me go," Lindsay told the judge. Then, turning to the family of Abrams, he shouted, "Everyone wants to point a finger at me." "Damn right," yelled Abrams' mother, Emma Williams. Good for you, Emma. Before being quieted by court personnel, I would not have quieted her. Several members of the victim's family who came to watch the proceedings began to cry. "What am I supposed to do, stand up here and say I'm sorry?" Lindsay asked the judge. "I'm going to find happiness like I always have. Inside myself," he said. Let me ask you, does it sound like Mark Lindsay feels guilty? Is he? Get the point? Guilt is a legal declaration that you're unrighteous. In the Bible, this guilt is a legal declaration by the judge of all. God brings down his gavel and declares you unrighteous in his sight. And it doesn't matter one bit how you feel. There are plenty of people who are guilty who don't feel that way. And there are plenty of people who are declared not guilty who still do feel that way. Our job is to figure out what God thinks and align our feelings accordingly. And when we talk to people about sin, there should be a holy guilt that they feel. And when we are declared not guilty in Christ, and he brings down that gavel, and because of the righteousness of Christ declares you not guilty, you should never feel condemning guilt again. I realize we do. But we need to align ourselves with the judge, and what he says is true. Well, that's the definition of sin unpacked for you. Just really quickly on some of these last points. The way humans fell is the way we continue to sin. We believe lies. You know, I've adopted these two little girls, and they have a lot of lies to overcome in their lives, being raised in the Buddhist culture they were, being raised in really tough families. And around our house, something we say a lot is, "That is a lie." And if it's a real big one, I'll say, "That is a lie from the pit of hell. Let's send it back." You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Thank you very much. And anything to the contrary is a lie. And so lies have invaded our thinking. And Satan just flat out lies about God. in his character, in his trustworthiness. And at the core, sin then is a failure to be satisfied with God. And the effects of this sin, guys, is that we're separated from God. We hate him. He rightly responds with wrath, and there is a severing of that relationship. There's a separation that happens. And this results in a separation even within ourselves. We have this horrible separation and duplicity in ourselves, and even the separation between body and soul in death is a tragic result. We've got separation with the creation itself. We've got this enmity, this thorns, thistles, pain in childbirth, sweat of the brow, adversarial relationship with creation, that we're always in a fight, always in a war. And then what happens is other human beings who were intended to be objects of love aren't objects of love. Because what happens? I get cut off from my source of life, my source of joy and satisfaction and significance and security. I get cut off from that source and I live life under the sun. And now what do? I try to find all that I am and all my security and significance from the stuff in this world. And you know what? So is he. So are you. And so rather than objects of love and self-sacrificial care and seeking the good of another, what does this person become to me? What do they become? Exactly. Competition in their separation. They want the stuff of this world. I want the stuff of this world. And I can't even drive on the 5 freeway without it being a dog-eat-dog competition. Get out of my way. And all these evil things come out of my heart. I'm not even late, but I will get in the carpool lane before you. I mean, it's a constant competition for the stuff of this world to find life. And what do? We've got to be the people who, because of God's initiative, return to finding our life in him, so we're freed from the stuff of this world as the source of our lives, and then we're freed to really again see people as objects of love. Because if they get the stuff before us, that's not the point. Who cares? It's not he who dies with the most toys wins. You know, that's a tongue-in-cheek bumper sticker, but it's sadly way too true. That's what's going on. And so it causes separation at every level. And this is caused by unbelief and pride and self-centeredness. And this leaves us in this state we started with in the hymn that we sang. Total inability, as you see on this list. 1, total inability to come to Christ and believe in him. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. God needs to do a miracle. He needs to move in and change rebellious hearts if we're ever going to know him. We're totally unable to see, much less enter the kingdom of God. Totally unable to submit to God's law and obey him and glorify him. We're totally unable, on a top of 84, to understand spiritual truth about him. Totally unable to, on our own, believe in Christ. Unable to please him. And finally, totally devoid of spiritual life. And this total inability doesn't mean that we're as bad as we can be by God's common grace. But guys, we should never be shocked by human evil. When we get this stuff, it's not going to be earthquakes and murder that shocks us. We're going to be shocked we made it to this class safely today. We should arrive at this class and say, can you believe, given human depravity, that every one of us made it here without being mugged and killed and robbed? But what? We're shocked by evil when we see it, not realizing that God's restraining common grace is holding back this evil all the time. And on the occasions where this is withdrawn and we see an unleashing of evil, we're stymied by it. But if we really get this, it won't be shocking to us when we see human evil.
Biola University offers a variety of biblically-centered degree programs, ranging from business to ministry to the arts and sciences. Visit biola.edu to find out how Biola could make a difference in your life.